If you could all take your seats, we are about to get started with our dinner speaker. I'd like to bring up my colleague, Amy Lutz. She's a program officer here at the Reagan Ranch Center and has put in a lot of hard work, along with the rest of the team, to make this event possible. If you're a student in California, there's no doubt that you have worked with Amy to bring conservative ideas to your campus through YAF. So please give her a round of applause.
Hello, everyone. You guys enjoyed the ranch today? Excited to introduce one of our warmest, most knowledgeable, and exciting speakers to you all tonight. Rachel Campos Duffy actually just spoke at California State University, Los Angeles, a couple days ago to a wonderful group of Young Americans for Freedom students. So if any of you are interested in bringing her to your campus, certainly let us know. She would be a great asset to most of your peers. Rachel Campos Duffy is a parenting expert, author, blogger, public policy pundit, and television personality. In her early 20s, Rachel was cast on MTV's iconic reality show, The Real World, which for some of you who might not know, is kind of the precursor to a lot of our reality shows today, in which she eventually met her husband and fellow Real World alum, Congressman Sean Duffy. Rachel's television credits are large and diverse. Currently, she is a recurring guest on NBC's Today Show. She has actually guest-hosted ABC's The View on numerous occasions, and has appeared on many different shows, including Dr. Phil, Fox and Friends, The Hannity Show, The Mike Huckabee Show, Politically Incorrect, EWTN's The World Over Live, and CNN. Currently, she works with the Libre Initiative, an organization that advocates for the empowerment of Hispanics through economic liberty and self-reliance. She writes for numerous online outlets, including the Today Show blog, todaymoms.com. She contributes to National Review Online, The American Spectator, CatholicVote.org, and NBC Latino, among others. Her book, published in 2009 by Penguin, is called Stay Home, Stay Happy, 10 Secrets to Loving At-Home Motherhood. In 2008, Rachel co-hosted the series Speaking of Women's Health on the Lifetime Network with the legendary Floris Henderson from the Brady Bunch, who you guys might know. Rachel has a degree in economics from Arizona State University. I know we have a couple fellow Arizonians here, and a master's in international affairs from the University of California, San Diego. She lives in Wisconsin with her husband, Congressman Sean Duffy, and loves being a mom to her 8 awesome kids. So if you'll help, give me a welcome to Rachel Campos Duffy.
So currently, I am also a Fox News contributor. So if you watch Outnumbered, if you watch Cashing In on Saturdays, you might be able to catch me on Fox as well. So listen, I want to tell you guys, I did just get back from CSULA, and that was an incredible experience of just what a great chapter. Almost entirely Hispanic, all the kids. It was, for me as a Latina woman, very edifying to see the kind of support, frankly, Ruth, donors like you are giving to Hispanics at a very liberal story. That CSULA is the birthplace of Chicano studies. It's a very liberal campus, and those kids, I could see that YAF was, it was part informative, part group therapy, I think, for all of us. It was really awesome, and they are brave kids who are just, you know, living out what they believe. And they're strong, and it's just incredible the work that YAF is doing to support them. It's great to be here with you today because nothing recharges me more in this battle for freedom than coming to the Reagan Ranch and getting together with young people like you, where I can literally see the future of our movement. And believe me, I think it's very bright. As you know, my name is Rachel. I'm a conservative activist. I'm a Fox News contributor. I work with various organizations, including the Libre Initiative, to economically empower Hispanics through free markets, limited government, all the ideas that you guys are learning about here at the Reagan Ranch. I am a mother of 8 kids and the wife of Congressman Sean Duffy from Wisconsin. Now, my husband and I, as was mentioned during the introduction, met on a reality television show called The Real World. And so let's see if we have the, would we have the clicker up here? Yes, let me see here. Am I not doing this right? There we go. No, one more. Well, that's my, let's go back one. So that's the, let's go back one. That's my family at Thanksgiving. We did some cultural appropriation there. If you can see, we got a little bit in trouble on Facebook when we posted that, but that's okay. We're conservatives. And then that's Sean and I, probably about a year after we were married, from the where we met on the Real World. So we're actually, believe it or not, I mean, this shows you how old I am, we are actually the very first reality TV couple to be married. And we definitely have the most kids of any reality couple that's ever gotten married. And as you know, my husband is also the first national politician to have come out of reality television show. Now, as you know, we've just inaugurated our first reality TV president. So depending on how the next 4 years go, you can either thank or blame my husband for blazing the trail. For years, I've been speaking all over the country about why popular culture matters in politics and how the left has really understood this much better than we conservatives. Now, Barack Obama was a master at harnessing the power of pop culture. But I believe that he has finally met his match in Donald Trump, who is, I believe, a true creature of popular culture. When it comes to politics, there are actually some benefits to being a reality television star. Now, one of them is that you learn to get very, very comfortable just being yourself on camera and in interviews. Now, people who know Hillary, for example, or even Mitt Romney, will tell you that in private, they're very warm and personable people. But of course, that never really translated for them on the stump. Now, how many of you watched the Mitt Romney documentary, Mitt? Anybody here watch this documentary? Can we move? Should I just stay there? Remember this documentary? I believe, now, if the warm and funny, personable guy that showed up on this documentary had actually shown up on the campaign trail, I think that Mitt Romney might have won. Donald Trump is nothing if not totally comfortable and confident in his own skin. The other most important reason why being on reality TV is a plus in politics is that you don't think that pop culture is beneath you. You actually understand and you respect its power. Now remember way, way, way back during the campaign when Donald Trump mocked Hillary Clinton for weeks about her health. You guys remember that? Yeah. Now, when it came time for Donald Trump to release his own medical fiscal, remember that? He had to do that. He did not have a boring press conference, which every other politician does. Where did he go? Do you guys remember where he went to release his medical records? That's right. He went on Dr. Oz. And when he did that, I tweeted about it. Love that at Real Donald Trump plans to release his physical with Dr. Oz, finally a GOP candidate with a gut instinct for popular culture. Now, the Beltway folks really mocked him for that, but it was really, really smart. Donald Trump understood, or he just intuitively knows, where the people are at. And in this case, he wanted to reach suburban undecided women, and guess what? Where's where they're at? They're watching Dr. Oz. Can you imagine for a second Mitt Romney, Paul Ryan, or Mike Pence deciding that they're going to go on Dr. Oz to release their medical information? It just would never happen. During the campaign, TMZ approached both Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump and said, "We have this great idea. Let's do a tour. We're going to interview you, and we're going to go to your home, and we're going to do a tour of your house by using all these different objects in your house." And Donald Trump said, "Sure, I'll do it." So he went on Dr. Oz. Well, we don't have that here. Hold on. I thought I had the Dr. Oz picture. Hold on 1 second. But of course, Hillary Clinton declined the offer. She said, "No, I don't want to do it." So I predict that over the next 4 years, Donald Trump will be teaching traditional Republicans by example, by his example, how to beat liberals at this very, very important part of the game. You see, the reason is that culture leads politics. In other words, politics
reflects what's already happening in the culture. I'm going to repeat that because this is really the crux of this discussion here. Politics reflects what's already happening in the culture. Politics is always trying to catch up to culture. It's always behind. So if you want to influence politics, first you have to change the culture. And to change the culture, you actually have to be in or part of the culture. Now, I don't want to denigrate the importance of policy. Policy is very important. It matters a lot. And people went to the polls in November for very important reasons, and they elected Donald Trump for very serious policy reasons. But they were attracted also to the messenger of these policies. And the messenger, in this case, is the only Republican since Ronald Reagan who understands the theater of politics. And that is why liberals hate Donald Trump. They hate him because they fear him. He is a threat to their cultural dominance in a way that someone like Ted Cruz can never be. He's the only one who will come close to perhaps surpass Obama in dominating popular culture. Now, the Obamas love being in the shows everyday normal Americans watch. It's why they have both remained so incredibly popular, despite the fact that income inequality, poverty rates, dependency on government, all of these things grew during Barack Obama's tenure. By the way, Hispanics, 2 million more fell into poverty under Barack Obama. Black family income dropped by $4,000 a year. So, you know, some of the people who voted most enthusiastically for Obama actually did worse. And yet, he remains so popular. The Obamas left office with sky-high approval numbers. They were around 60%. And that is very high. Ronald Reagan left office with about 64%. But remember, he actually brought down the evil empire without firing a shot. So, politically, Obama has very little to show for. Legislatively, his record is very thin. His only big achievement was Obamacare. And we're seeing in just a few weeks, we're going to see the beginning of the dismantling of Obamacare by Donald Trump and the Republicans in Congress. So Obama presided over the worst economic recovery since the Great Depression, and yet he left office very popular. How? The answer, of course, is popular culture. So let's look at how Barack Obama infiltrated popular culture so successfully. It's interesting because Obama himself is not actually that cool. He wears, where are we at? I don't think the clicker is working, so maybe y'all can. Now he wears mom jeans, and we can see that right there, right? Next clip, he wears, that's the TMZ clip from before. Let's go, continue on. He wears a bike helmet. However, President Obama is cool by association. Obama is cool because Will.i.am sings his campaign songs. He hangs out with Jay-Z and Beyonce, and he dances with Ellen, and he slow jams the news with Jimmy Fallon. No other sitting president or first lady have penetrated popular culture more than Barack Obama and Michelle Obama. Now, you guys may be too young. Next slide. You guys may be too young to appreciate that Ronald Reagan and Nancy Reagan were really huge television and film stars. But yet, in their first 4 years of office, Barack and Michelle Obama surpassed 85 years worth of media appearances by Nancy and Ronald Reagan. Just think about that. Barack is on ESPN giving his March Madness picks, which, by the way, I think we can move that one forward. Yep, there he is. He's mocked by Republicans for that. By the way, interestingly, ESPN asked Donald Trump if he wanted to do March Madness pick. And he said no. And I thought about that. Why would Donald Trump say no to doing the ESPN? Because I think he understands his brand. His brand is, I'm getting to work. And so in this case, that one didn't benefit him. And so I just think it's interesting the decisions he makes when he decides to do it or not. From Jimmy Kimmel to Rachel Ray, The View, Iron Chef, The Biggest Loser, the list goes on and on. Now, Michelle Obama is actually better at this than her husband. Let's take a look at this clip here. No, the back, there we go. Do we have that downloaded? No. Yeesh. It's not going on? All right. That was a clip of her basically in the car lip syncing. And it's actually a really fun clip. She's incredible at it. I mean, if you saw the clip, which you can't see it right now, it's fun. She's engaging. In fact, today, or this past weekend, was the finale of the Master Chef for Kids, and she was on that as well. So she is not afraid to go into pop culture, and she's actually better at it than her husband. Michelle graces the cover of every magazine from Redbook to Vogue. Elle. Oprah, let's see. I think we have a picture of her on a cover here. Do we have her there?
One second, I'm gonna try and get your video going.
All right, let's try and look at that. All right. Sorry about that, guys. Oh, there we go. I know you guys might get up and dance on this one. It's not going, okay. So if they're not going to get the video, let's just, there we go. Okay. So Michelle graces the cover of every magazine from Redbook to Vogue to Elle to Oprah. This, of course, as you can imagine, is a huge advantage that she has in reaching women. Now, Melania Trump, next clip over. With her impeccable style, is actually, I think, presents a chance for the GOP to sort of revamp its image, which sometimes comes off as some people think is a little dowdy. So already, I think she, and you can look from this outfit, she's the most fashionable first lady we've had since Jackie O. And I think women of all ages were mesmerized by every single outfit she chose around the inauguration. For years, she was part of their world as an international fashion model. And then, of course, she was part of the fashion world herself as a high-end customer. Now, because of politics, the fashion world wants to shut her out of that fashion scene in New York. Tom Ford, for example, and there are other designers, publicly stated that they will never dress our new First Lady. Now, can you imagine for an instant if a designer had said that about, say, Michelle Obama. Of course, we can imagine all the racial slurs that would have come about had somebody said that. Melania has certainly not been embraced by the fashion world the way Michelle Obama or even Hillary and Chelsea has. I think we have some photos of Hillary and Chelsea there. Next. Uh-huh, there's Hillary. Does anyone take fashion cues from Hillary or Chelsea? Now, we know that Melania will never, for example, make the cover of Oprah. Nonetheless, I believe that over time, it will be hard for the liberal fashion world to resist the allure and the style of Melania or Ivanka. There she is in that inaugural gown. Michelle Obama has been on sitcoms like Parks and Recreation, dramas like NCIS, Nashville, the kids shows from Carly to Sesame Street. She's at every single Teen Choice Awards. She showed up at the Oscars, if you recall. Barack Obama is not above doing shows with YouTube stars and radio DJs with names like Pimp with the Limp. he appeared, actually, this is an interesting fact. He appeared more times on The Daily Show with Jon Stewart than he ever visited Congress. We kind of talked about that, Ruth, about how, you know, Donald Trump is already engaging so much with Congress and trying to do those negotiations. He was on The Daily Show more times than he ever came and visited Congress. So why haven't Republicans been doing these things? Well, part of it is that many Republicans think that pop culture is beneath them. It's not dignified. For others, they worry that they will not get a fair shot. And that's true. They probably won't. And to be fair, conservatives are not always asked to be on any of these shows. However, I would argue that we conservatives need to push harder to be part of mainstream popular culture. We cannot simply sit back and cede popular culture to the left. We can't just continue to preach to the choir on Fox News. So in 2016, in this presidential election, I believe that liberal elites also underestimated the power of pop culture. They underestimated the power, the star power, and the media skills of Donald Trump. You know, Obama publicly mocked Donald Trump for being a reality television star and for running beauty pageants. He forgot that Donald Trump had been in the homes of millions of Americans for decades. He had been for decades honing his skills in media and in the celebrity culture that we live in. Let's take a listen to Michael Moore talk about this. This was from a show that was on maybe 2 days after the election. Let's take a look at that. Can we get that clip? Oh, dear. There we go. Yay.
Liberals, you don't watch Celebrity Apprentice. I watch TV. Most of you don't own a TV. I watch Celebrity. I watch American Idol. I know that Jennifer Hudson lost in Asia. You're right. And I know in America. Yes, I live in America. I watch. Yes.
But she'll be.
I watch The Bachelorette. Like everyone else, I should win. Caitlin picked Sean.
Oh
Nick.
My God.
Nick was going to win, and then Sean.
It should have been Nick.
Yeah, of course it should have been. That's the country we live in, but then I tried to get liberals to understand.
I'm asking this question.
Come out of the bubble and live in the world your fellow
Americans
live in.
Do you remember Ruben Sutter? I loved him.
So. I've been on The View more than 25 times as a guest host, and I've had several joint appearances, actually two, with my husband, Sean. And when we go on, we actually make a pact in the green room that we're not going to talk about politics. We go on The View to talk about our kids, about our family. As you know, my husband's a lumberjack world champion, speed climber up those poles, so we talk about lumberjack sports. Our goal when we go on shows like that is to make sure people get to know who we are, to help break down some of the liberal stereotypes and caricatures of what a pro-life Republican looks like, talks like, what they care about. The left, again, is scared of Trump. They have publicly stated what their strategy is for dealing with Donald Trump. And their strategy is, and they're very open about it, it's called don't normalize Donald Trump. I'm sure you've heard that. Don't normalize Donald Trump. And there is severe punishment in the entertainment industry for anyone who does. Why? Why is there such a deep penalty for that? To normalize Donald Trump is to normalize Republicans. And to normalize Republicans is to normalize our conservative ideas and give them a fair platform from which to be debated. Look what happened to Jimmy Fallon when he had Donald Trump on. Let's play this video from Jimmy Fallon.
Did I miss your hair? The answer is yes.
You know he hated that. But by poking harmless fun at Trump, and by the way, Jimmy Fallon the week before had Hillary on and gave her the same sort of softball, fun little interview. But by allowing Trump to play along and show his good humor, of course, Jimmy Fallon in that moment humanized Donald Trump. And in doing that, he invited the wrath and ridicule of his Hollywood peers. He was attacked by Tina Fey, Samantha Bee, David Letterman. Samantha Bee, by the way, she was so angry that he was even allowed to be on the Today Show, the Tonight Show. In fact, she had a whole monologue on how and why he should not even be allowed to appear on it. And she said, quote, "I guess ratings matter more than brown people," whatever that means. Matt Lauer, if you recall, was also dressed down by the liberal media and the Hollywood crowd because they were mad that he was not harsher on Donald Trump during one of the presidential town halls. The lesson was loud and clear. You will be vilified and attacked for normalizing Republicans or giving them any platform that actually allows them to come off looking good. The left knows that it is dangerous for conservatives to be normalized in popular culture. Now, unlike any other politician before him, Donald Trump isn't afraid to fight back. On Twitter, of course. He called the Broadway hit Hamilton after, remember, Vice President Pence went to watch the show with his family and he was verbally accosted. And of course, Meryl Streep as well. He called them both on his Twitter overrated. By the way, she won 20 Oscars, or been nominated for 20 Oscars. It was kind of a weird thing to say, but he's not afraid to take them on. He mocks his detractors from Rosie O'Donnell to Arnold Schwarzenegger. The media, Democrats, and even establishment Republicans tell him to please be presidential. Stop tweeting. Stop talking about Arnold and the ratings on The Apprentice. But Donald understands that if he retreats from pop culture, he will lose his connection to millions and millions of Americans. If he disables his Twitter account, he will lose his only weapon against the biased media. And he knows that the left knows that. Donald is an existential threat to the Democrat Party. You may not know this, but in this election, over 100,000 working class Democrats switched their party affiliation from Democrat to Republican so they could vote for Donald Trump in the primary. In his first week in office, what did Donald Trump do? He brought in, first of all, he announced, "I am going to do, you know, $1 trillion in infrastructure projects," which is, you know, music to a lot of Democrats' ears. But he brought in the union bosses. The Democrat union bosses had them over to the White House. And all of these union bosses described this meeting as incredible. If he has the economic success that he has had in his first month in office, He will win re-election. Now, just think, in the last few months, I mean, wages have gone up. The employment numbers are going through the roof. The boom in housing and buildings have gone, I mean, it's 50% increases. They haven't seen these kinds of booms in construction in decades. So we're seeing, I think, the beginning, the seeds of some real opportunity for our country. And I think that's what he will be judged on ultimately, is his economic success. Another important thing that Donald Trump will be doing while in office is teaching a new generation of Republican leaders how to harness the power of popular culture and social media. How to punch back at a biased media instead of just taking it. And how to go above the heads of the liberal gatekeepers and speak directly to the American people through Twitter or through other unscripted rallies that he does and he's continuing to do around the country. Donald Trump, like Barack Obama before him, understands that you cannot win the culture if you are not in the culture. And this may be, quite frankly, the first time the Republican leader actually beats a Democrat in this. So today, I challenge all of you, because you are so young, so vibrant, so informed, so eager to learn about our conservative ideas, I'm challenging you to consider that maybe the best way for you to make a difference in our movement and in politics is for you to make a difference in culture. So what is a young conservative to do in the face of our very liberal culture? Here is the really good news I have for you. Our conservative message, believe it or not, actually sells. Seriously, young people are not rejecting our ideas. Americans don't reject our ideas. They're just not hearing them, or at least attributing. They're not attributing these values and these ideas to the conservative movement. I want you to see this video right here, because it not only proves that conservative values lead to the American dream that everyone wants, but that many Obama-loving celebrities don't even realize that they may actually be closet conservatives. So let's take a look at this video.
Think about the last 5 years. Enter our protagonist. Enter the most powerful force for change on the continent. Enter the strongest, loudest, clearest voice for progress. Enter! Commerce. Entrepreneurial capitalism takes more people out of poverty than any, of course, you know that.
I believe that opportunity looks a lot like hard work. When I was 13, I had my first job with my dad carrying shingles up to the roof. And then I got a job washing dishes at a restaurant. And then I got a job in a grocery store deli. And then I got a job at a factory sweeping Cheerio dust off the ground. And I've never had a job in my life that I was better than. And every job I had was a stepping stone to my next job. And I never quit my job until I had my next job. And so opportunities look a lot like work.
So all my little homeboys and homegirls back in the city, I came up in that same county building. Food stamps, welfare, Section 8. Check it out. You looking at me on TV right now, this is living proof that you can do anything you put your mind to, you feel me? Real talk. They call us the minority, you know, the black and brown, blacks, Latinos, but for sure, if you keep love, God, respect, and hard work in your heart, you can do anything you want in life, all right?
I mean, it's all about hard work, I think. For me, that's what it was about. I went and I took dance classes, and I offered my help to work at the desk so I could take all the free dance classes that I wanted. Because that's what I wanted to do. I think that eventually hard work, dedication, and a willingness to learn everything without any ego is what is really the recipe for success. And you have to really know who you are. You really have to remember where you started, who you are, and nobody can change that.
our values. These are the things that we believe in. These are the things that lead to success, hard work, self-reliance. I love that story about Jennifer Lopez. I mean, your parents are too poor to afford to put you in dance class, and you're resourceful enough to go down and go, you know what, I'll work your desk for free so I can take those dance classes. That's what conservatives do. Conservative values sell. Entrepreneurial capitalism lifts more people out of poverty than aid or anything or any other system of government. And you should know that when you see those Bernie Sanders rallies that we saw that everybody's, all your liberal friends are missing from last summer. All those kids who say they want Bernie Sanders should take their spring break over in Venezuela right now, where people are starving, where the people who make the bread in Venezuela are being arrested. They don't have enough wheat and flour to make the bread, and the government's trying to say it's the fault of the people, the guys that are baking the bread, instead of what's really going on, which is socialism and a system that is impoverishing a country that has more oil reserves than anywhere else, and probably one of the top three in the world. Conservative media and entertainment makes money when it is done well. And in fact, according to Movie Guide, conservative movies made 3 times as much money as liberal ones. The average conservative movie makes $71.5 million. The average liberal movie, $22.5 million. Remember Hacksaw Ridge? How many of you saw that? The year before, this movie is really about religious liberty. Last year, Unbroken that Angelina Jolie did? That was phenomenal. Again, another movie about faith and dedication. And the power of Christian forgiveness in the case of Unbroken. Narnia, Lord of the Rings, these are franchises that are incredibly successful. Do any of you guys know who Andrew Breitbart is? Yeah. You guys know Andrew? Andrew was a friend of mine when he was alive. Andrew lived in LA. He's an amazing person, and he was very passionate about pop culture because he grew up in Hollywood. And being just a little older than I was, he was actually a really huge Real World fan. I actually met him for the first time here. I came for a meeting with Sean, and he was kind of such an uber fan. It was a little bit scary. He knew a lot about the Real World, and I thought he was kind of a stalker at first. But he wasn't. He just loved pop culture, and he loved that there was a conservative Latina on MTV. And he once told me that as a movement, we would be winning if conservatives had bought a movie studio 20 or 30 years ago. He understood that the battle was in the culture before the before the ballot box. So here's the deal. You do not have to wait until some rich conservative buys a movie studio or NBC, though of course that would be very helpful. But all of you sitting here today have the potential to be powerful culture makers. In fact, you are already doing this stuff on Facebook, on Twitter, on Instagram, on Snapchat. In your hand, in your pocket, you already possess the power to be opinion makers, trendsetters, thought leaders in your school, on your campus, on the internet, in your jobs, and of course in popular culture. Do y'all remember when this happened? Was it 2 summers ago? One more up here. Whoops, one more back. There we go. Do you guys remember the Planned Parenthood videos that were exposed? Sharing those videos on social media has already changed the debate on Planned Parenthood and their taxpayer funding. So the liberal media was never going to show these videos. They had to show. I remember I watched it on NBC News. Why did NBC News cover this story? Because it went viral on the internet, and you guys all made it happen, and they had to cover the story. And right now, because that changed the culture, because people saw these videos and it was like pulling the curtain back on these butcher shops. And today, Congress is on the verge of voting to defund Planned Parenthood. That is culture changing. And that was done through social media. After the inauguration, there was a video of a woman that went viral. She was, let me see here. No, that was it. I don't have the video here. She was sitting on a plane. Do you guys remember seeing this? She was on a plane, and luckily it was caught on video. She sat next to a Trump supporter. I don't know if the guy had a hat on, how she knew he was a Trump supporter. And she refused to even sit next to him. And that was caught, and it was really wonderful because there's so much talk about how intolerant conservatives are. And here was a woman who wouldn't even sit on an airplane next to somebody who didn't vote the same way she did. The way that you guys are videotaping, this was when a conservative speaker went to speak at Berkeley. This is the kind of intolerance. They're not open to listening to ideas. And all of you young people are on your campuses documenting this. You guys are really citizen journalists reporting on the violence and the intolerance on college campuses across America. Young people like you will lead the way. I really implore you to volunteer at your local Republican parties, help your conservative elected leaders be more effective at communicating. Help them, because they need you. They're not good at it. Help them bridge that gap between politics, culture, and technology. Now, my husband loves to take selfies. It's like a thing he does. And he takes them not just with the kids. He likes to take them with all the influential politicians he meets in his job. And he wanted to find a way to engage with young people in politics and introduce them to the policymakers that are actually making a difference in their life. And so he had a very young, wonderful comms director, communications director in his office. And this young woman said, I'm going to help you put all your selfies together. And this is what Sean put together. And I'll tell you what happened after we did. Oh, one more back. There we go.
All right, I'm on the way to the town hall. But first, let me take a selfie.
So it was funny because the young comms director worked with some people. She put this together, and we, Sean's chief of staff said, I don't know, Sean, if you should, you know, people already think, you know, aren't you worried? They already think you're a reality television star. They might not, you know, this might just feed the beast that you're not a serious politician. And he said, let's run it by some consultants. And that I know I have a friend. He's a consultant in politics. And the consultant said, do not let your boss put this up. And so then Sean called me, and he said, what should I do? And I watched, and I was like, oh, my God, of course, post for sure. And so he posted it. And what was interesting is it went viral. I mean, it was, like, on Mashables. BuzzFeed picked it up. Everybody was sharing it. And interestingly, in our own district, all these kids started sharing it. And that was what was most interesting to us, because we were able to capture all those young people's data. And so now they're getting a lot of conservative information going to their own media platforms. So it ended up being a really great thing and a really good example of how we need to step out and do things differently and stop listening to all those political consultants. Finally, if you're interested in journalism, broadcasting, creating new platforms for social media, here at YAF, by the way, we have the journalism school for when all of you guys go to college, another great thing that this organization does. If you're interested in acting, directing, producing, filmmaking, I encourage you to go for it. These are some of the most influential fields out there because they directly influence and impact policy and politics. You are the future. You can shape the next generation of conservatives, of freedom-loving citizens who can defend entrepreneurship, American capitalism, limited government, the ideas of self-reliance and hard work, rule of law, and a culture that respects life in America. Thank you guys so much for having me here today. It's always fun to be here. Yeah, I'll take questions.
Hi, Zach Rickmeyer, Mater Dei High School.
Where's your high school at?
Mater Dei in Santa Ana.
Okay.
So my question is, you mentioned earlier about the emergence of reality politicians. Do you think that's the new norm? And if so, do you think that's beneficial to American politics?
I think that I don't think somebody should become a politician or that it's a qualification necessarily because you were on a reality television show. Not every reality television person is the right person for the job. But I do think, I really do believe that it can help you hone some of your skills. If you already have an interest in politics, it can help you hone your skills. Now, I wouldn't have thought that when it's not why Sean got involved. It's not why I did The Real World. I certainly don't recommend that as like your, you know, reason for doing it because you think you're going to be the next president. But I wouldn't necessarily shun it if the right opportunity came your way. Is it good for America? I don't know. I mean, I look at my husband. I think he's a great leader. I think he's doing the right things. And so much of his job involves communications. And let's face it, Republicans have not always been very good at communicating our message. And so I think he's a real asset to the Republican conference because of that. And I think it can help him. I think it helped us. I would be lying if I didn't tell you that it doesn't help us, or it didn't help us, at least in the first election. People knew who he was. A lot of what you do in your first election is spending money to get people to know who you are. And if they've already seen you on TV, you kind of have a little bit of a leg up on that.
Hi, my name is Bryce Asberg from Tacoma, Washington, Wilson High School. And I'm sure you're somewhat limited in how you can answer, given your husband's role. But could you elaborate on your position on the American Healthcare Act?
Sure.
If you think it's going to pass the way it is, if it'll be modified, and which way?
Great question. So I feel a little more encouraged today after I saw that Donald Trump brought in some members of the Freedom Caucus. And the ones that were there at least left the White House saying we're on board. We still need a few others to get on board. The piece of legislation is a three-part process. So when people are complaining about that bill as it is right now, they have to first of all understand it's that bill plus everything that Tom Price as Secretary of Health and Human Services can do to roll back regulations that were put in place by Kathleen Sebelius when she was Health and Human Services. And then hopefully before the August break, if they pass it now or shortly thereafter the August break, there's another piece of legislation that will include things like allowing people to buy insurances across state lines, tort reform, which, by the way, is so important. And so those things will help lower costs. And I think that's the goal. The goal of the Republican bill is to lower the cost of insurance so more people can buy it. Now, I know that there's some people in the Freedom Caucus who are upset about it, and they think that the bill is not conservative enough. And part of the reason is what the Republicans have done, what Paul Ryan has done in this bill, is, you know, health care is a big deal. I mean, it's like turning a giant aircraft carrier. It's not something you can do like that. So you're moving from this big centralized idea of Obamacare to eventually get to some more free market solutions that will lower costs. And in the interim, they provide sort of a soft landing place so that as they make that transition, there are people that will get caught kind of between the cracks and lose coverage. And so they're trying to put in some supports in there. And there's some conservatives that say, no, we don't want that. We're against those kinds of supports. And I think, and this is my opinion, I don't think that Rand Paul gets to decide what's conservative and what's not. I think there's a lot of ideas under our tent, and I think it's a very conservative idea to make sure that families aren't hurt in the transition from Obamacare into a more free market, Ryan Care, Trump Care, whatever you want to call it. So I really push back on that personally. I've done it on TV. I reject the notion that it's not conservative enough. Maybe it's not conservative enough for Rand Paul, but I think it's a perfectly conservative idea. And by the way, it's kind of politically smart, too. I mean, you have a lot of people who lose coverage in the transition. You're going to get hit politically, especially during the midterm elections. So I think it's the right way to do it. It's maybe not as radical as some people would like, but I think it's a good plan. Oh, sure.
Hi, my name is John Serrano. I'm from San Bernardino, California.
Hi.
I'm going to Palomar College, and my question is, What would be some advice you could give to somebody that would like to go into pop culture and get a conservative message across and receive minimal backlash or at least deal with it somehow?
Wow, that is such a good question. So there is this group apparently in LA. My husband's met with them. They're called what, Friends of Abe? So they're like this closet group of conservatives who give each other support and try and help each other out. Listen, it's tough. They're definitely blacklisted. So I don't recommend you come out as a conservative, but I recommend that you get good at your skills, whatever that is. If you're a director, if you're a producer, if you're an actor, be good at what you're doing, and try and sort of through great product, right? Through delivering a great product, hopefully you can influence it. I mean, I look at sometimes some of the cartoon movies that my kids watch. They're so anti-capitalist. It's always like the big, bad, money-making people. And they really denigrate the idea of entrepreneurship. And so there are things that you can do to make, you know, maybe the business guy is not the villain in your movie. Or, goodness and morality is actually, redeemed at the end of your movie as opposed to other movies we've seen. So I think there's ways for you to sort of, pack the spinach into the popcorn. I mean, I don't think anyone likes to go and see a movie that is really overtly, conservative, if you will. I mean, I think we all want to be entertained. We all love good stories. And I think there's ways to do that by just bringing your own value set to the products that you make in terms of entertainment.
Hi, I'm JJ Warren. I go to Boise High School. And what do you think the ultimate goal of the Democratic Party is?
Wow, that's a great question. Well, I mean, listen, I mean, we can look at what they were doing over the last 8 years. For example, we talked a little bit about healthcare. I think Obamacare was never their goal. Their goal was, single payer, completely government controlled. So we know what their goals were in that regard. As a parent, I get worried about what I see. We see so many dysfunctions in our world, in our country today, and so many of the dysfunctions we see come down to the breakdown of the family. And so I think it's really important when you're talking about what we can do in the entertainment world or so forth. We really need to come back to a place where the family is valued, because when we have families, I mean, the number one predictor of poverty in America is when a child doesn't have a father around. That's the number one predictor of poverty. So there's lots of things that we can talk about, but denigrating the family, the unit of the family, and policies that disencourage people from getting married and having, perfect, a lot of times what the liberals want to do is very well-intentioned. They want to help a single woman, but sometimes the way they set up these programs actually disincentivizes them from marrying the father of their child, because if they marry that guy, then they'll lose the welfare benefits. So there's lots of things that government does to try and help that actually ends up hurting. And we need to start thinking about what are the things that really drive our society in a positive direction. And we know that a family unit is the most important thing. And so we need to start looking at those ideas. And what is the left doing that actually breaks down those ideas, intentionally or unintentionally? Yes.
Hi, my name is Elias Gracia from San Diego, California, and I attend Helix High School. I was
nice
just
to meet
wondering,
you.
Which advice do you have for a conservative trying to reach the Latino community? Because obviously it's a bit more difficult because of what you recently said, that the Democrats say that they'll lose all their benefits if they become conservative.
Sure.
And so I would just like some help with that.
Oh, you know what? So I would really encourage you, and actually what we'll do, maybe Jolie, we can send my video story. Maybe we can send it out to everybody. I have a couple videos. One is mine. Another one is a man that I know named Daniel Garza. And we did this really cool video of our American Dream story. So my dad came. The reason I say that is because I think people, our brains are made for stories. It's why Ronald Reagan, by the way, when he gave his speeches, he always gave his speeches and stories, because our brains are wired for stories. And so it's a story about my family. It's a story about my friend Daniel Garza's family, and how, my father came from a very poor copper mining town with all Mexicans, first generation in the mountains of Arizona, and how he was a shoeshine boy, and how he made his way through self-reliance and hard work and all these things that are the foundation of the American dream, and how my family achieved the American dream. I want to make sure that you get those stories, because I think showing those videos to someone explains in a really crisp way, 2 minutes, what conservatism really is about and what its aim is, which is to lift people up so they can create their own dreams, not the dreams the government has for them, but the dreams they have for their own families. And so I want to make sure you get that video. We'll make sure you get it. It's a great question.
This will be our last question.
One more. Reason.
Okay.
One more.
Two more. I'm open.
Hi, I'm Derek Panucci from Moon Air High School in Pennsylvania.
Nice to meet you.
a reality show star, what is your input on actors and actresses having a say in politics?
I think everybody gets to have a say in politics. I don't care if it's an actor or my neighbor. I mean, I think we all get a say. They all kind of come from a certain point of view. I wish that there were more voices, more different voices coming out of that community. But I think it's really incumbent on us to bring that diversity. I think a lot of it comes to, I just came back from that college. And, you know, that college talks so much about diversity. They want diversity of race and sex and incomes, and they want diversity of gender. And the only diversity that they reject is diversity of intellectual differing opinions. I mean, they don't want diversity of opinions in those schools. And so I think that we all have to continue to challenge our schools and our communities so that there's a diversity of ideas, a marketplace of ideas for people to pick from. That's our job.
Hi, my name is Alex Dunn. I'm from Fort Bragg, North Carolina.
Sure.
And your video on the closeted conservatives.
Sure.
My question is, how do you go about combating the liberals like to pose the question, what if, and they also like to say but a lot,
mm-hmm.
and suggest, further things. So how do you personally combat those questions that come further?
What do you mean by that? Can you give me a little more?
Like, if I were to show that video in my class, a lot of the students at my school would be like, yeah, but, and they would say, go on some tangent about, oh, the government doesn't allow us to get there and stuff.
Sure.
How do you combat that personally?
So, it's a very good question. I think it's really hard to argue with a personal story. So, for example, a lot of Hispanics have the experience of living in places where there's tyranny, where there's corruption and lack of economic liberty. And they leave those countries to come here. And so I think a personal story about what's your family's American dream story, or how did your family, your father, your grandfather, your great-great-grandmother, how did they come to America and find success? And it's pretty hard to argue with the personal story because it's your story. So maybe, that's what each of you should, take away from this as well, beyond the pop culture, is going back and thinking about your own families and what is it that made your family succeed? What are those values that are conservative that helped your family advance from wherever they came from, whether it was from Ellis Island or from Sonora, Mexico, or wherever? What is that story? And you should know that story. You should be able to tell that story. And again, I really encourage, we'll have Jolie send those links around to all of you so that you guys can see what that might look like and you can tell your own stories. Thank you. Thank you, Jolie. Sorry about the video clips.
Let's give it up for Rachel one more time. Okay, if you will all bear with me, I have quite a few announcements for you. So tomorrow, we're excited that, today was a great day at the ranch. Tomorrow will be our final day. I know it feels like you just got here, but for tomorrow, unless you have made arrangements with me, which is...
stay an extra night. So unless you are staying, like unless you are departing on Sunday, you are to check out of your rooms tomorrow and bring your luggage.